ओके Okay, today I'm going to start microservices. This whole week we're going to see what is microservice, how to work with microservice. The complete thing we're going to discuss in this whole week. Okay. Actually, this is my website. Okay, this is the article I have given. What are microservices and what setting up config server? What is the full things I'm going to return. As of now, it has only config server and the Eureka Minimum server. Okay. If you have any doubts, you can go and check here. Any idea about what is microservice? You people are already in development, right?
I am into development only, but I am not into development of microservice.
Okay. What about Navishri?
So we are also not using this microservice.
Okay. See, microservice is nothing but it's a simple web application. It's a RESTful web application. That's it. Microservice is nothing but a Spring Boot. It's a simple Spring Boot application. Simple Spring Boot application. Using Spring Boot application, on top of that, we are adding some features. Using that feature, we are making that as a microservice. What do you mean microservice? See, microservice architecture is a service-oriented architecture. It's style of architecture. It's a particular style of architecture. Using that approach, we can break large system, large monolithic system into smaller component, smaller independent component. Very important is independent component. It has a own server. It has a own port number. It has a own endpoint. It has a own deployment unit. Okay, it's a completely act as a separate application. Separate application. It's an independent service. It's an independent service. Again, it's a Spring Boot only. There is no technical difference between a Spring Boot and a microservice. Microservice, if you want to create any small component, we have to use whatever whatever we learned in the past 15 days, right? We have to use that technology to implement a microservice. On top of that, we have to do something to enable a microservice. Okay. A microservice is a small component. It's a small independent component. It has a own port number, own endpoint, its own process, own deployment unit. Okay. So we are going to split a larger system into multiple smaller component. Each component run individually. Okay. Now why we want to split a larger system into multiple component? For example, let's say I have a three model in my application. Okay, so account service on Spring Boot application, product service Spring Boot application, reporting service Spring Boot application. I have three Spring Boot application. Okay, and this Spring Boot application we have constructed as a single unit. For example, let's assume that we have this product service for this account and the product and the reporting, everything as a module. It's not a separate service. Everything available in a single application, single web application. Okay. Now I want to modify anything in the product service. For example, I want to add some feature in product service. What you have to do? We need to do and changes in product service model. But when you deploy, right, we need to deploy the entire application, because account module, reporting module, product module, everything is tightly coupled, everything tightly binded in a single WAR file. It's a in some if you want to deploy any web application, you use a WAR file, right? Some years back, we use WAR file. That WAR file you deploy in Tomcat server. Okay, now that WAR file contain all the module as a single unit. Whenever do any changes, we have to redeploy the entire application. This example is a very simple. What I am showing is very simple. Account module is one module, product module is one module, and the reporting is one module. It's a very simple application. Let's say PayPal. PayPal is a very big product company, right? It has a multiple teams. It has a multiple features in the PayPal. Okay, now we met multiple people going to work. Now, before the microservices, what they will do, they have to deploy as a single unit only. They have to deploy as a single unit. For example, they are going to add some feature in their application. The particular team only work for that feature. Other team don't work, right? Particular team will work. After completion of that feature, they have to deploy. In order to deploy that feature, they have to build the entire PayPal war. An entire PayPal war. It's a big process. One small team doing some changes. For that changes, they are redeploying the entire application. It's a serious problem when you come to the big organization. It's a small application, okay, that's fine. So to avoid this kind of situation, we can go with the microservices. Okay. Also, we can do very fast development. I want to do only some feature and product service. People focus on the particular module. They can do some changes. They can deploy. It's an independent deployment, right? I said that it's an independent component. It's a own deployment unit. So using that, we can deploy that particular service alone independently without affecting other services. Okay, let's say now before that you know what is the microservice. Microservice is we are going to splitting a larger system to smaller component. Each component is having its own deployment unit, its own process. It has a one endpoint. Okay, this is called as a microservices. But we need to enable that's a cloud environment. What is the cloud environment? We need to make that application as a cloud enabled. I can see here I have three services. Now, according to this picture, I have three services: account service, product service, reporting service. Three services, each one is a Spring Boot application only. It's a Spring Boot application only. Okay, it's running independently. Client want to access account service, client want to product service, client want a reporting service. How to do that? That is the one question, right? We are splitting into larger, we are splitting the application into small component. Now each is having a own endpoint, own server, right? But if you want to client interact to the in this application, which endpoint they are going to use? Are they going to use account service? Are they going to use product service? Are they going to reporting service? Here is the problem. So we have to give three endpoint to the client. It has three different endpoint. We have to provide three different endpoint to the client. If your microservice not enabled with the cloud component, if your Spring Boot application not enabled with the cloud, okay. Spring Framework provides some cloud component. Using that cloud component, we can add that cloud component to this microservice through the Spring Boot application. Once you add that, this component became a cloud enabled. Cloud enabled means if you want to call any service, we can provide only one URL to the client. Based on that request, automatically your cloud component go and interact to the particular service. Let's say I want to communicate account service to product service. If this component is not enabled with the cloud component, what you have to do? If you want to communicate one Spring Boot application to another Spring Boot application, what we have to do? We have to write some bunch of code. There is a REST template. Using that REST template, we have to write a bunch of code to communicate with one service to another service. If you're enabled with the cloud component, Spring Boot cloud component, we don't have to write any single line of code. Through some declarative program, you can communicate one service to another service. Okay, then another example is products. Let's say it's a festival season. In the festival season, there are a lot of people are coming and interacting to this product service, right? That time what I can do, I can scale up the product service. I can bring one more instance of product service, because a lot of people coming to product service only. They are coming to account service, they are not coming to reporting service. They're coming to only product service to purchase some product. So in such a case, I can increase one more instance of product service to perform good. I can increase one more instance of product service. I don't want to increase account service. I don't want to increase reporting service. In the case of monolithic, what we'll have to do? We have to scale up everything because it's a single application. But in this case, which service, in which service user interacting more, in the particular service, we can increase the instance, increase the dynamically, we can increase the instance. If there is no user, if there is no peak hours, we can scale down automatically. Okay, we can scale down automatically through that. How can we do this? Through a Spring Cloud component. This is called as a cloud. This is a cloud enabled environment. This is called as a cloud enabled environment. If you're not enabled, if you're not enabling cloud here, what will happen? If you want to do any particular activity, for that you have to write a bunch of code. You have to write a bunch of code. Let's say if you want to communicate one service to another service, you have to write a bunch of code. Okay. Then I want to track logs. Something happened reporting service. Something happened reporting. Whenever said client send a request, something happened reporting service. I want to track that log. That is very difficult if this component is not cloud enabled. Through a cloud component, we can easily track the logs. This is called as a cloud environment. If you want to say simply, all Spring Boot application collaborate very easily one microservice to another microservice. Very easily using cloud component. This is called as a cloud enabled architecture. Okay. Now in the throughout example, we're going to see how to enable all cloud component in our Spring Boot application. Once you enable the cloud component in your Spring Boot application, each Spring Boot application act as a microservice. Okay, microservice nothing but it's a simple Spring Boot application only. On top of that, you are adding some cloud component to make it cloud. Okay. So Spring Cloud component, these are some Spring Cloud component: config server, service registry, API gateway, Spring Cloud load balancer, circuit breaker, Spring Cloud sleuth and a zipkin and a fine client. These are the some cloud component. We're going to see how to collaborate with each microservice using this cloud component. Okay. I hope you understand what is a microservice, what is the cloud environment, how to make the cloud enabled by using Spring Boot cloud component. Okay. Once you enable the cloud, once your application enabled as a cloud, what will happen? You can collaborate with each service very easily. Okay. Now we need to learn only this cloud component. We have already learned Spring Boot. Using that Spring Boot technology, Spring Boot features, whatever you learned, right? Using that, we can create a microservices with the help of this cloud component. Okay, now we need to check what is config server. Here, whenever you create a one web application or RESTful web services, that application having some configurations, right? That configuration will keep in application.properties files or application.yaml files. Correct? We're going to keep application.properties file. That file will be available in the resource folder of your web application, resource folder of your RESTful web application. Whenever you want to change anything, any configuration, what you have to do? We have to go to resource folder. We have to open that file. We have to change that your configuration. Then we need to redeploy or restart the application. So in this case, in the case of monolithic, that property is tightly coupled within your part of your web application. Tightly coupled. It's not a loosely coupled. It's a tightly binded with your application. If you want to change, you have to go and change and restart the application. That is the way. But in the case of microservice enabled technology, microservice, we will going to maintain all the config files in separate area, separate location. It's a centralized location. That is in our repository, GitHub. I hope that you people know GitHub, right? Git repositories. You worked on Git repositories, right? Hello?
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I don't have to teach that. If you don't know, there are many videos, or I'm going to post one small videos. How, what is the Git? How to work with the Git? Okay. So we're going to keep all the configuration in the GitHub repository. Okay. Here I have three services: account service, product service, reporting service. Right. Now each service having a own configuration. Account service having one configuration. Product service having one configuration. Reporting service having a one configuration. Now this configuration, I don't want to keep individually each microservice. Okay. We can move all the configuration in GitHub repository. In the GitHub repository. Then from that GitHub repository, I can load that configuration in your respective microservice. Then how to load that? For that, you need to create one a config server. That is a config service. You need to create a one config service. That config service, again, it's a Spring Boot application. You have to create one Spring Boot application. In that, you have to add one proper artifact. That artifact, that is starter project, that starter project enable that Spring Boot application as a config service. Once enabled as a config service, that particular service go to the Git repository and pull all the properties of your microservices. Whenever any property needed account service go and request your config service. Config service get that property and they give it to account service. Okay, through this we can maintain our configuration in centralized location. Also, if you change anything, any property in your configuration file, you don't have to restart. Without restarting, that changes automatically get reflected. This is one of the benefits of config service. Two things I can see. One is we can change our configuration without restarting the server. Second one is we can keep all the properties in centralized place. You can maintain perfectly. What is the purpose of config service? Using config service, we can maintain all your microservice properties in centralized place. Okay. Now, so this is the microservice on a design architecture. Okay. Our intention is we want to create three microservices that is related to business. Okay. What business you're going to do? According to that business functionality, I want to create three microservices. One is a, let me open in a paint. One is account service. Another one is product service. Another one is reporting service. Okay, in our we are developing some billing system. Okay, in the billing system, this there are three modules: account service, product service, reporting service. Okay, now I want to make this three each module as a separate service. Account module I want to convert as account service, product module I want to convert as a product service, and a reporting module I want to convert as a reporting service. Now I want to get three different Spring Boot application. That three different Spring Boot application act as a microservice, Here, this three Spring Boot application, account service is account service need a database, product service need a database, reporting service no need database. Account service pointing to one DB, that DB contains all account related tables. Product service contain pointing to one DB, that product service that particular DB contain all the details of products, product related tables available here. Okay, reporting service always interact with product service, account service to fetch, get the reports about the account, get the reports about the product. Okay, this is my three service microservices respect to my business need. Based on my business need, I come up with a three services: account service, product service, reporting service. Apart from this service, I have to create some more services to make them as a cloud enabled account, to make them as a cloud enabled. If you use only these three services, that is not a microservice. That is not a microservice cloud enabled environment. We have to add some cloud component to make them cloud enabled microservice. For that, I have to create one config server. Just now we talk about config server. What is a config server? Then we need to create one more service called API Gateway. And we need to create one more service called Service Registry. That is a naming server. Okay. We'll talk about later about API Gateway and the Service Registry. Our intention is we need to create a microservice enabled component for my account service, product service, reporting service. Okay. For first step, we need to create a config server. To start this work, as a first step, I have to create a one config service. I have to create a one config service. Okay. What if the circuit breaker and the sprinkler? I will talk about later. Okay. About this. Now I want to create a config service. Then I want to create a service registry. Then I want to implement this three microservice. Then I have to use API Gateway. Okay, the API Gateway, config service, and service registry, three act as another microservices to collaborate these three component properly to enable a microservice environment. Okay, now I want to create a config service. Let's see how to start with the config service. Okay. So this is the config service architecture. Now account service, product service, reporting service, they all service interacting with the config service. This config service interacting with the repository, the Git repository. From the Git repository, it loads all the configuration that needed for account service, product service, reporting service. Now I want to create this config service. I want to create a config service or config server. Okay, let's see. In the D colon, I'm going to create a separate folder called MS Cloud Demo. Microservice Cloud Demo. Okay, here first I want to create a repository. In this example, today we're going to see how to create a local repository, how to connect the local repository. I want to create a local Git repository. I want to connect in that local Git repository my config server. Okay. For that, you need to install Git client. Okay. Go to Google. Install this client software. It's a very easy, straightforward, self-explanatory. Okay, easily you can install this. Download based on your operating system. Once you install this, go to Windows PowerShell. Windows PowerShell or Command Prompt. Either you can go to Windows PowerShell. Just type Git. If you set Git, type Git. It will return a lot of help commands. That meaning your Git is installed properly. Purpose of this Git client is you can interact with your Git repository. For example, this is my Git account. If you don't have a Git account, please create one Git account. Okay, we need this. We have this is my Git account. Okay, in this Git account, you can see here. Go to repository. Here I have a config repo, configs, billing system, Java, Tamil, IT garden. There are many repositories I have, right? Okay. In this repository only, we have to maintain all our application configuration file. Okay. As of now, I'm not showing from here. I'm not showing the demo accessing property file from here. Okay. I'm going to create a local repository in my local system. From there, we can see how to access. Okay. Then we'll switch to how to connect with the remote Git repository. Okay. This is the remote Git repository. Okay. Okay. So this Git is used for to manipulate your GitHub server, to manipulate your GitHub server. Okay. I want to add some files. I want to commit some files. Those activities we can through this Git client, we can do all the operation, committing file, adding file, removing file, whatever Git operation you want to do, we can do through this particular client software. Okay. I'm going to MS Cloud. What is that? D colon, right? The D colon MS Cloud Demo. So in this folder does not have anything now. Now I want to create one Git local repository. I want to create a Git local repository. For that, you have to give Git init. If you say Git init, it will create a, it initialize one a Git local repository. Git local repository. Here, as of now, we don't have anything, right? Okay, before doing this command, I want to create one more folder. Here, msconfig repo. MSConfig repo. I am keeping as a name as a MSConfig repo. This particular folder act as a my local repository. Here only I will going to keep all my configuration files. Okay. Later we'll move this folder to in our real Git server. From the server we'll going to access the configuration. As of now we're going to see how to access the configuration from our local repository. Okay, I'm going inside the msconfig-repo. I'm going to say git init. When you say git init, you will get this command. Initialized empty git repository. Initialized empty git repository at the location ms-config-repo. When you say here, you can see one folder, hidden folder, .git. It has some configuration files of Git. You don't have to worry about this. Okay, if you created this, you have created one Git local repository in your local machine. Okay. Then, now I want to, where is that? Yeah. Here I copied three files. Account service -yaml, account service -dev.yaml, account service -qa.yaml, then service registry.yaml. Okay, as of now we'll talk about only these two. I'll go and remove this. Okay, you don't have to use those files. Later we'll add. Okay. Now this account service and account service registry.yaml. I'm going to create two microservices. One is account service, another one is a service registry. As of now, our intention is we need to see how to access configuration file from the Git repository. That is our intention now. Okay. Now we are going to create a config service. Through the config service, I want to load this property files, load these YAML files. That is our intention. For that, I copied two files, account service.yaml, service-registry.yaml. Okay, two YAML files I copied here. When you look at here, I don't have much information. Server port number. My account service should run port number 9092. Still, I have not created account service. Okay, this is just a property file. That's it. I'm keeping inside a config folder. Then application name is account service. Then billing app. This is my own attribute. I am saying this is billing app account default service, account default service. Okay, I will explain why I'm saying it's a default. Later I will going to explain. Then when you open a service-registry, here also I am saying what is the port number of service registry. 8761. This service is nothing but Eureka naming server. We'll going to talk about that also later. Okay, then Spring application name equal to service registry. Then billing app equal to this billing app service discovery default service. Default service. These properties I will talk about when I teach about Eureka naming server. Okay. So as of now we have a two config files. One is the account-service, another one is the service-registry.yaml. Okay. Now we're going to check how to access these files. How to access these files through config server. For that, I created one local repository called ms-config-repo. ms-config-repo. Inside this particular folder, I make it as a git local repository using git init command. Okay. Then go to spring.starter.io. I'm creating a config service now. I may name it as a config service. Then config service demo. Then package name is a comrade ID card and version is 8. Okay. Then here you have to add one component, one dependency, that is a config server. Okay, it's a config server. I am adding a config server component. This is enough. So if you want to enable one Spring Boot application as a config server, we need to add one dependency called config server. Okay, we need to add this dependency called config server. I added now, I'll go to generate. I'm going to extract this service now. Folder zip. I'm extracting the zip. I have a config service, the default files. Now I want to import that folder here, that config service project here. File new project from existing source. Select pom.xml file. If you're doing first time, it will take some time to load all the dependencies. Okay. It's loading. Okay. I have loaded that. Then I'm going to rename it as application. See, this is not a mandatory, okay? You can keep it a config service application also. So I want to keep it too short. So I make it as application. Go to application. Here you need to add one annotation called enable config server. That's it. Enable config server. If you want to create a config server, we need to add an artifact called config server artifact, Spring Cloud config server. Spring Cloud config server. Once you added that, go to the application file and create, go to application main file, then add at enable config server. Okay, now you go to start the application. Okay, now it's giving some error. What is that error? Okay. Then I'll going to remove this application property file. So I want to use the application YAML file. Okay, just I'm removing it. New file application.yaml. There is another project. I'll copy these properties from here. Okay. Okay. Here in this YAML file, I'm saying Spring application name equal to config service. My application name is a config service. Then cloud config server git. Inside a git, there is another attribute URL. In that URL, you need to tell which. What is the location of your Git repository where you are maintaining your configuration? As of now, we are maintaining where locally, right? This is pointing the remote URL. We don't want to do that. We have to use locally now. So locally, this is the one local, right? So we need to use this syntax. I'll going to remove this. I'll make it comment. Then I'll going to copy this. So here I'm saying URL equal to file. This is a very, very important. You need to follow the syntax. File colon triple slash. Then D colon MS cloud. MS hyphen cloud is in demo. Slash, what is the repository name? It's a MS config repo. This is a repository name, right? So I'm going to use this name. Okay, whenever you say like this, your config server go and take this property, whatever property files, whatever YAML file available, it's load that property file, keep it in the config server. Okay, then I'm saying this port number is a 888. Port number is a 888. Okay, we need to keep track all the port numbers, because going forward we're going to create multiple web services. So each one is having a unique port number. We'll maintain the unique port number. So I'm going to use always 888 for the config service. Okay, whenever you use the config service, my port number is a 8888. Okay. So now I'm going to start the application. It is coming from where? Okay. So your application started now. Application started at 8888. Port number 8888, right? Now I want to test this config server. This application loaded or not. It's able to loading whatever configuration available here. whatever configuration available for files available here, I want to check whether it's able to load or not. Able to load or not. For that, we can test the browser itself. Go to the browser. http://localhost/8888 port number. Then you have to use your application name, that is the file name. See, we have to maintain the application name very properly from now onwards. Okay, it's a very important. Okay, I'll going to create one service called account service, still not created, but I keep it that configuration file, the config file. Okay, when you create a account service, we have to create in this name only. Okay, that is a very important. Okay, also the YAML file is something like that. Okay, similarly like that we have to follow. Now I want to load these properties. For that you need to say the application name, then default, then say default. If you say this, it will not work. White label error page is coming. I am calling correct URL only, then I am saying default, then I am saying default. Okay. Whenever generally in the project we have multiple environment, right? Multiple environment: dev server, QA server, and a staging server, and a production server. For each service, each server we have different profiles, different profiles. Let's say if you are using dev server, means we have to follow like this, right? Dev. You have to say dev. Now these are my dev property files, dev configuration files. Here I can say this billing app account dev service. I'm saying dev service. Here I am not mentioning anything here. That meaning it's a default. That is the meaning of default. I told I explained later what is the meaning of default service. It does not have any profile data. It just saying account-service.yaml. So it's a default profile. It's a dev profile. If you want to access any in a profile configuration file, you have to say we have to use that particular profile name. Here we have to use a profile name, that is the service name, followed by you have to pass profile name. I want to access my default profile name, so I am saying the account-service default, but it's not providing the data. If you want to access dev, you have to say same thing. Still it's not providing a data. Okay, why it's not providing a data? Why it's not loading the configuration? I created the repository, then I just pasted this file. Actually, I have not committed. I created a repository called ms-config repo, initiated the repository, empty repository. In that empty repository, I have not committed any files. Okay. According to this config server, it assuming that does not have anything here. But I copied, but does not committed. That really committed into the local repository. First, we need to commit. If you want to load any configuration through config service, that file must committed. Okay, we have to commit that. If you go to that repository, say git status. Git status, you can see it's saying that no commits yet. Clay says no commits yet. Untracked files. There is a 3 untracked files. Untracked files mean these files not committed. The files not committed. Use git add file name. Please, it's suggesting, please add this file to git repository. For that, we need to use one command called git add space followed by which file you want to commit. Okay. We need to use this git command to add the files first. Git add space file name, but I want to add all the files, so I can simply put dot. You can simply put dot. When you say dot, the git add command add all files to your git local repository. Git local repository. If you say git status, what's happening? Now it's saying green color. Previously it was saying red color, right? Now it's giving the green color. It says new file. It's a new file. You added some new file. Okay. But still this file is not committed in the your local repository. Local repository. Okay. For that, git commit. -m adding first config files, adding account config and service config. Adding first account under service config. Service config, service registry, that means service registry config. This is a comment. We have to give some comment. Then enter. Three files changed. 25 insertion. Some is giving, right? Some response giving. That meaning my files committed to the Git server. Committed to the Git server. Now I'm able to see. Now for that, I'll restart the server, config service. Started now. Go to the browser. Now you can say dev, default. See, when I say default, it's giving all the data which is available in the account service YAML file. You can see this data here. Sorry. This is building up account default service. Building up account default service. So, that port number, application name, everything, whatever data available here, that's just loading and showing it here. So now our config server able to load the files. Now I want to see the dev account service. So I'm able to see dev, also it's loading default. Why it's loading? Whenever you say any specific profile name, it will show that profile respective YAML file here. After that, it will show it's a default file. That meaning it's providing first priority to this particular configuration. In case this file is not available, this file is not available here, what will happen? It will load automatically default. That is the meaning of this. Whenever load specific profile, that profile show by default first, then it will show default one. Okay, now I load the dev. So through this we can access, through this way we can access the properties through the config service. This I am showing the demo how to access the properties files through config service. In the application model, we don't use this endpoint and all. Okay, just we will go into point. This endpoint will go into point. Local of 0.0.0 going to point each microservices. That microservices use this endpoint, load the property files. Okay. Now I'll going to change some data here. Demo. Whenever you change, we have to commit. Don't forget to commit. Git add, git commit, -m, adding new content. See, one file changed. I changed only this file, right? Automatically saying one file changed. We have to follow these two steps to add this, to commit the files. Okay. One file changed, one insertion. Now I'm going to load this. See, it's reflecting. Without restarting, we can load the changes. In the case of single application, monolithic application, what you have to do? Whenever change any properties, we have to restart the application. Here, we don't have to restart. I changed the property file. I have committed the changes. When I refresh it, it's coming. Okay. So now we have completed the config server. Config server creation. We have created the config server. In this architecture, as of now, we completed only config server. Next, I want to create a service registry. What is service registry? It's a naming server. Service registry nothing but a naming server. Okay. If you want to create a naming server in a Spring Boot application, we have to use Heroka naming server. Okay. It's a Spring Boot application. Naming server is again it's a Spring Boot application. We have to add one more Spring Cloud component called Heroka naming server. On top of your Spring Boot application, we need to add Heroka naming server. Once you add that Heroka naming server component, cloud component in your Spring Boot application, that Spring Boot application act as a Heroka naming server. What is the purpose of naming server? So Heroka naming server is a Spring Boot application. It is a REST-based service. Heroka naming server keep track of all services running in microservice cloud environment. Use of the Heroka naming server is it sold all the information about the microservice running in your cloud environment. Here you have account service, product service, API gateway, config service. All services registered inside a Heroka naming server. Okay, all services registered in Heroka naming server. Using this Heroka naming server, we can see that how many services are running in your Spring Boot, in your microservice environment. How many services running, how many services not running. This information you can see. Actually, this service hold the information about our service. That is, for example, this account service having a unique port number. It's having a unique endpoint. Those information available inside a service registry. That is a Heroka naming server. Okay, so whenever, for example, let's say account service want to communicate product service, what will happen? The account service can don't know, right? Account service is Spring Boot application. It's don't know this product service available or not. How can we can find out? How to know account service? What is the endpoint of our product service? What is the endpoint of port number of product service? Through those things, this service can know through the service registry, through the naming server. It will ask, hey, what is that URL and endpoint of product service? It will give those information. Through that information, it's able to communicate product service. Okay. Let me explain that. Where is that? So Heroka naming server, it acts as a service registry, as a service discovery. Okay, whenever add any service, that particular service information registered by our Heroka naming server. Whenever any service want to talk to particular service, that service find by Heroka naming server. Heroka naming server go and find that service. Where is that service available? It find the service and give that information and give it to the particular service. Which service want to talk? That is the purpose of Heroka naming service. We have to maintain Heroka naming service. Through that service, we can register whatever microservice available inside our microservice environment. Also, we can find which service you want to talk. Okay. Next step is we need to create a Heroka naming server. Now in this architecture, we'll come to now how to create a service registry. I'll going to name it as a service registry. Okay. For that, we need to create a new project. Okay. Go to spring.io.config here. I am saying service registry packages IT Garden jar is 8. Then I will go to remove this. I will go to add a dependency. Eureka server. Just you want to add the Eureka server. Just add this Eureka server dependencies. Now I want to extract that here. Okay, it's already there. Okay, I want to extract to the same location. Now we're going to import. File, new, project from existing source. Service registry, prompt.xml file. Select the prompt.xml file. Click OK. Click new window. It's loading the dependencies. In the prompt.xml, you can see one artifact that Spring Cloud started Netflix Eureka server. This Eureka server is implemented by Netflix. Okay, so it's saying Spring Cloud started Netflix Eureka server. Okay, now I'll go to create a Eureka server. Let's see how to do that. Rename it to application again. Again, you have to say enable Eureka server. That's it. If you enable, if you add this tag in the application configuration class, it's act as a Eureka server. Now I want to add one more some properties. I'll take it from here. Not here. Okay. Just copying these files. Now I want to keep this is from here. Close it. This is from MS Cloud. Okay. I'm removing this file. Okay, removing this file. No need application property. Just copy this. I'm going to create one more file called application YAML. Application YAML file. Application YAML file. And then copy this. Okay. So application. I created one property YAML file called application YAML. The port number is 8761. This is a port number we'll use for a service registry, Eureka naming server. Application name is a service registry. This application, this is billing app service discovery default service. I will talk about later about these properties. Okay, I don't want to explain now. This is our folder, right? Here we have in this repo already I copied. Already one I copied one configuration file for service registry here. Okay, I don't want to use this. As of now, I don't want to use this. Okay, so that I am creating a locally. The service is locally I am creating. Okay, locally I am creating. I'm going to comment out this. Then I enabled with the enable Eureka server. Okay, we have to, what is the step? You have to create a project. That project should have a Netflix Eureka server dependency. Then the application file should have a enabled Eureka server annotation. Then in the property file, I given a port number as a 8761. Then application name is a service registry. This is my our one attribute. Let's start this application. The server is added. See here, the port number is running here. We can see the port number. We'll check what is the 8761. If the Eureka naming server dashboard, by default they are providing a dashboard. This dashboard showing that instance currently registered with Eureka. Instance currently registered with Eureka. Okay. I will tell what is the meaning of that. Don't worry about this error now. That meaning, whatever microservice registered in a Eureka naming server, those service name show in this dashboard. Whatever service running, available service running, service name information show here. As of now, it's showing service application name is service registry instance currently registered with Eureka. That meaning I created only this application, right? Now what's happening? This is a Eureka server. It's registered. This Eureka server as registered as a client. This Eureka server itself registered as a client under showing that name. I don't want to do that. Okay, and for that I can enable this property. Actually, this is a service. It will show whatever service running in your microservice environment. I want to see only those service. I don't want to see that Eureka server as a register inside Eureka server. That server itself registered inside a Eureka naming server. I don't want to see that report. If you don't want to see that report, you have to enable this particular property. Eureka client registered with Eureka. Okay, Eureka client registered with Eureka equal to false. Fetch registry equal to false. You have to enable these two attribute. Once you enable two attribute, this information will never show. I want to show only my config service. I want to show only my account service. I want to show only that other service. I don't want to show this service as registered inside Eureka server. Okay, so I am enabling this particular property. I am restarting now. Now server is started the application. Server is see started the application. Now we'll go into refresh this. See, does not have, now that report is not showing here because I don't want to register my naming server as a client here. Okay, I don't want to do that. So I make it registered with Eureka false, fetch-register false. Now my intention is whatever microservice I am creating, those service I want to register here. Okay, I want to show here how many services running. Okay, already I created one service called config service, right? Config service. I want to register that service in my Eureka. Okay, for that we need to do some step. We have to follow some steps. Before that, I want to move this configuration. I want to move this configuration. Configuration the config service. Okay. I don't want to read this configuration from here itself. I want to load this configuration, whatever configuration available here. I want to use it in my repository. Okay. For that, I'll just copy this. Open this YAML file. Yeah, this file I already have. That's good. This file already have that configuration. So remove this, just remove it. Then here we need to create one more file, one more property file. That is bootstrap.properties. We have to get a bootstrap.properties. Okay. In that property file, we need to add one property, which is, I will tell that by opening this. Just add this property, Spring application dot name, Spring dot application dot name service registry. My application name is a service registry. Then I'm here, I'm saying spring dot cloud dot config dot URI. If you want any configuration specific to service registry, specific to my Heroica naming server, please use this endpoint, load the configuration. I'm saying please use this endpoint, load the configuration. What is this endpoint? This endpoint is a
is the endpoint of our config server.
Yeah, config server. Okay, so this service registry pointing to our config service endpoint. From this endpoint, it will load. Since I am using service registry, it automatically use this. Based on profile, automatically use this dev or QA, whatever. It will happen automatically. You don't have to worry about that. Okay, so if you want to use your config service, in a particular microservice, let's say that here service registry is a microservice. I want to use this microservice configuration from the config service. We have to create a one file called properties file called bootstrap.properties. In that properties file, we need to tell what is the application name, your application name. My application name is the service-registry. Then you need to tell what is the URL of, what is the endpoint of your config server. That's it. Okay. Then copy your service registry YAML file in your config repo. Config repo. Then make sure that you are committed this file. Make sure that you are committed this file. Okay. Apart from that, you have to add one more step. Let's do that without adding the step. Okay, I'm going to start this server then. Okay, here I mentioned please use this config server location. My config service is running, already running. Okay. Restarting my service registry. My expectation is it should use these bootstrap properties, load the properties from my config service. But it's not happening. See, it's pointing Tomcat initializes with port number 8080. But my port number is not that, right? When you see a service registry, it's giving, I've given 8761, but this is saying, this console saying, service is console saying 8080, that meaning it's taking default port number. It's not at all reading from here, not at all reading from here. Okay, so for that you need to add here two more endpoint. I will tell, sorry, not a two more endpoint, it's a two more starter projects, two more artifact, that is two more dependencies you need to add. copy that, go to service registry. This artifact for to enable this application as a Eureka naming server. These two artifacts, these two dependency for to load the configuration file from the config server. Okay, I'll stop this and reload. I'm reloading pom.xml file. Yeah, it's disappeared. Clearly it disappeared now. Now we're going to restart this application. Now we can see port number is 8761. That meaning it is reading from our config server. That meaning it's reading from our config server. So this application now connected with this particular config server. This particular config server. Open that. Not this one. I want to tell one more thing. The config service. Yeah, that's it. Now we are successfully configure naming server, that is service registry, then config service. Two services were registered. We created as per this architecture. Okay. Next step is we need to register this config server inside a service registry. We need to register this config server inside a service registry. We'll go and see how to do that now. Application YAML file config service. Okay, there is another one is okay. Now our intention is we need to register our config service inside a Eureka naming server, right? For that, we need to add one more artifact in the client side. Okay, now Eureka naming service is a server, right? Whatever microservice we are going to create, that microservice act as a client of our Eureka naming server. We have to make that. We have to tell these microservices are client of yours. We need to tell to the Eureka server, this microservice is a client of yours. Please keep track this information about this microservice. We need to tell through some configuration that we can do in two configuration. The first one is the artifact. We need to add this particular artifact in the pom.xml file. We need to add this particular artifact. Okay, I'll go to this config service and adding this artifact. Added, then I'll go into reload. Let them reload. Then next one is in the config service application YAML file. We need to tell the what is the URL of your Eureka naming server. Okay, that also we need to tell. I'm going here under. Sitting it. Okay, now I'll go to start this my config service. So we added two things. One is Eureka client artifact. Another one is we are saying that where is your Eureka service running. That we are saying through this attribute. Our Eureka server already running, right? Our Eureka server, yeah, it's already running. Let's see what's happening. So you can get some additional logs. Discovery client, your Eureka naming server find these services. It's running in this port. It's giving randomly generating some URL. Then it's giving that IP port number, right? It's registered in this path. If you want, you can use this particular path to access the config server. It's saying like that. Okay. I'll go to the Eureka naming server dashboard, refresh it. So here you can see config server registered with Eureka naming server. You don't worry about this. That is happening some internally. It will disappear after some time. Once you register, it won't show it immediately. It will take some few seconds. Then only it will show. Now we have created a config service. We have created a service registry. Then for service registry, loading the properties from the config service. Then we have registered the config service inside a service registry. These things we have seen today. So part of this architecture, we have created a config server service registry. We are able to load the configuration for service registry from the config server. We are able to register the config server inside a service registry. This part is completed now. Okay. Tomorrow we'll going to see how we're going to create a account service, product service, reporting service. These services for only business implementation. I will not focus much functionality of billing system. Okay, just I'll go into simple example, very simple example. I'm going to use the account service, product service. Our focus is only to understand this cloud environment, understand this Spring Cloud environment. Okay, we're going to create this account service, product service. We're going to collaborate with this microservice environment. Okay, we'll see that tomorrow.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah, tell me.
We followed some steps to make our service registry to read properties from config server, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can we use same steps to make any REST API to read properties from config server?
Definitely, you can use.
Okay. So same bootstrap that properties.
Yeah. You can.
Thank you.
Any questions so far? Are we comfortable? Still not subscribe this channel? Please subscribe it. Share this video to your friend circle. Click bell icon for regular updates. Thanks for watching this full video.